Steve Gill.
Hey, welcome back in. This is the Steve Gill Show. 800-688-9522. The phone number, that's 800-688-9522. Todd Starnes in studio with us. Has his new book, Dispatches from Bitter America. It was just released. You can also go to his website, Todd Starnes, TODDSTARNES.com, ToddStarnes.com. Find his blog that, has about twice as many people as Drudge read it every day. At least. That's my pitch. And you should be reading it as well. Great new book detailing what we are thinking. And, you know, Newt Gingrich has been pointing out for a while, Todd, that when you look at the issues, if you can put aside the I'm a Republican, I'm a Democrat, and we've gotten this mentality, it seems, in the country of what team are you on? It's like literally college football in the South. Well, I'm for Alabama and whoever's playing Kentucky, or, you know, whatever the mentality is, it's my team, your team. You get past that and just ask people where they are on the issues, whether it's abortion, whether it's the economy, whether it's foreign policy. We're pretty much in agreement in this country. And as Newt Gingrich has pointed out, we're center-right. There's 70 to 80% agreement on most of the key issues. And yet we keep getting busted, you know, in Washington with the left wing winning every step of the way. Why is it what America believes can't translate into reality in Washington?
You know, I think because Republican candidates aren't just battling the candidate, they're battling the mainstream media. And they really drive the narrative here. You know, as you know, Fox is the number one cable news outlet. But look, many more people watch ABC, CBS, NBC Evening News, you know, the old school, you know, evening news broadcast. And those folks are slanted way to the left. Look, folks who've seen these debates, especially the ones on the other networks where, you know, it's just been brutal. And you really wonder why Republicans would continue to put up with that sort of foolishness, you know, exposing themselves to those crazy questions.
I mean, real journalist George Stephanopoulos, who is nothing more than still a political shill and yet pretends to be a fair and unbiased journalist. You mean that kind of report?
Exactly that kind. And look, you know, we've got a chapter. I was talking to Michelle Malkin. We did an interview in this book about the bias in the media and how it plays out. And to give you a great example, we've seen the mainstream media cover these occupiers. And, you know, I've been down in New York City having to cover those folks with the cans of Febreze. And when you look at the coverage of that, just, you know, a handful of folks, compare that to what happened a couple of weeks ago when you had almost 300,000 people marching in Washington for the pro-life movement.
Didn't get any coverage.
No coverage at all. How do you explain that as you know, as a mainstream media news director? How do you explain not covering 300,000 people marching in the streets?
Because it doesn't fit your agenda. And you've
That's
got
right.
These so-called journalists, Chris Matthews, who sees as his role to make Obama successful, not hold him accountable, not be a reasoned critic of what happens. His job is to make Obama successful, and he's straight up about it.
Well, absolutely he is. And look, the big concern now, and this is I think this is going to help Rick Santorum moving forward, is this blatant attack that the president has launched on Christianity. It's not just religious liberty, but he's also been attacking Christianity. And I outlined this in the book since 2009 when he wanted to have the Nativity scene removed from the east room of the White House. From the White House. And when you look they've been removing Bibles from Walter Reed Army Medical Center, banning prayers at National Cemetery in Houston. They banned Franklin Graham and Shirley Dobson, James Dobson's wife, from the National Day of Prayer event at the Pentagon. This is happening under the Obama administration, so this is no surprise what's happened.
4 years ago, 17 million evangelical Christians sat on their hands and stayed home. President Obama won by 8 million votes. The difference, literally 4 years ago, was evangelical Christians. I know Ralph Reed's group is focused on registering 4 million more evangelical Christians, getting 7 million to turn out at the polls. We're seeing the Catholic bishops more engaged politically, saying Catholics need to get involved in the political process. Will it change the dynamic?
Oh, I think it will. I was talking to Bryant Wright last night. He's the president of the Southern Baptist Convention, the nation's largest Protestant denomination. He tells me that this issue has united Catholics and Southern Baptists. That hasn't happened before. So now you've
got seen the issue of Israel uniting evangelicals and
exactly.
Jews.
Exactly. And look, remember there was a meeting, about a month or so ago in Texas among top evangelical leaders trying to coalesce behind one of the candidates. And each of the candidates had a surrogate come and speak, make their pitch. I had a source in that meeting. It was a private meeting. A source told me that when the Romney people came in, that they had this holier than thou mentality, and it was almost this attitude of, if you don't support Mitt Romney, you're going to be some sort of a bigot because you're anti-Mormon, and that was the attitude that folks got out of that meeting. And I don't think that we've seen Mitt Romney reach out to the evangelicals, and he's got to have their support if he wants to get the nomination.
It's too late at this point, though, to do that. I mean, you know, people, it's like the South, Todd. You're a Southerner. We don't just gravitate to somebody immediately. We might be nice to you immediately, but there's not a real connection until there's some depth there. You don't win evangelicals. You don't win conservatives. You don't win people in red state flyover country simply because, well, you have an obligation to be for me. And they've never made that connection. They have been, if not distant from, disdainful of conservative media, conservative talk host, conservative leaders, evangelical leaders. And now when they need them, you can't fix that by just pushing a button.
Sure, and look, take away the presidential hair, and what do you have? You got a guy in leisure slacks and loafers who likes to go around shooting guns and killing, quote, varmints, as Mitt Romney said. You know, people see through that, and they want somebody who's the real deal. One of Mitt Romney's surrogates in New Hampshire said this. He said, electability trumps principle and belief. I tweet that quote about once a week just to remind people that this could be the mindset of the Romney campaign. They're going to do anything, say anything to get themselves elected, because at the end of the day, that's the most important thing.
And that may be true in November. I mean, you know, I think for a lot of folks, they're saying anybody who can beat Obama will be good enough for me, but you got to win the primary to get there.
Exactly. And look, and saying that, I don't think it's necessarily that he's a moderate. I suspect that conservative Southerners would support someone like Chris Christie because he is adamantly pro-life. He's certainly moderate on other social issues, but at least he tells you where he stands on something. Right or wrong, he tells it like it is, and people appreciate that. They can respect that.
Some critique Romney is saying he's our Al Gore, that it is the all head, no heart personality. Again, it is not really the issues. He is a pro-life governor. He is good on fiscal policy. I think he is socially conservative, just not adamantly and viscerally and emotionally in the same way that maybe Newt Gingrich, maybe a Rick Santorum. It's that technocrat approach that may be the distance.
Well, I think it's a very good point. Rick Santorum, though, is really making a connection with people. And you go back to New Hampshire, and I remember when folks were going out there buying the Rick Santorum sweater vest. You know, you're starting to see the lighter side of Rick Santorum, and you know the guy likes his sweater vest.
Thank God he chose sweater vests instead of leisure suits, because I'm not ready for America to go there. You got a few more minutes. You got to run to another.
Yeah, got a few more minutes.
Hang on, because I want to get to the other side and talk about how we get through the technical aspects of what it takes for Santorum to win. There's no doubt he's got the momentum, he's got the mobilized votes that are turning out, but he's not on the ballot in Virginia. He's not on the ballot in Indiana. There are states coming up where he is on the ballot, but he's not on the ballot in congressional districts, which mean no delegates. He can't get to 1144, which is what you have to win. Are we headed to a brokered convention? Polls say Republican voters don't want that. If we go there, how do we end up with a nominee, and does that work with somebody that can beat Obama? We'll talk more with Todd Starnes. New book, Bitter America. Dispatches from Bitter America is new book. ToddStarnes.com, the website. And we'll talk more about if Santorum's the guy with the momentum, how does he become the guy with the delegates? We'll talk about that in just a moment. This is the Steve Gill Show.